That is on watershed management.
Respected Dr. Roy Saab and participants of training. I'm Dr. B.K. Bhatt and I will be discussing about watershed management, particularly the center's experience in the field of watershed management. Just we'll go, you are from different disciplines, just a simple watershed. Actually, the watershed management project starts with watershed only. Watershed is there, actually, we should know what is the boundary of watershed. The ridge is there, the boundary, and then there are some separate streams, and water goes out from a single outlet. Only then that is known as watershed. Then there is watershed management. Actually, watershed management, it is a preservation of and maintenance of land and water. There are several means to conserve the land and water. So, in this, there are the main things which can be used. They are reduce the damage by flood, then check the soil erosion, and then sterilize the areas where runoff or soil loss is occurring, and then water harvesting and water resource development. This is one of the main components. With our experience, we felt that if water resource development or water harvesting is there, then people take more interest. So then we have to improve the quality of cropland, grassland, then forest land, and wasteland also. And in general, we have to improve the quality of residence of the watershed. Quality of living. Their production should increase. Their income should increase. Next, please. Sorry. The Shivali region. We are here at Shivali region. So Shivali region is spread in about 3 million hectare area. And particularly, we will be discussing the Shivalik of Haryana, Punjab, Himachal, and Jammu Kashmir, and Chandigarh itself. So this region provides electricity and irrigation to many of the northern states. Siltation or reservoir in the region. There is a lot of siltation because the soils are very fragile. Lot of silt comes from the catchments, and so the dams. So dams are reducing their life. See the Bhakra, Them, and the Pong dams are there. There, the siltation rate was estimated at 5 tons per hectare per year, but they are getting more than that, about 7 tons or more than that per hectare per year. So more sediment they are getting in the reservoir, so their life is reducing. So there are various catchment treatment schemes are there, catchment treatment plants are there with the forest department. They are treating the catchment so that less silt is produced and reached to the reservoirs. Then perennial streams converted to ephemeral streams. When we are going for soil and water conservation projects, then many times the streams which are not perennial, they can be converted to perennial. Because actually, what is happening about 10 years or 20 years back, the streams which were perennial, they have been converted to ephemeral. Ephemeral streams means they are getting less water only in the rainy season or after that only. The groundwater depletion is also there. And the participatory watershed management have demonstrated the benefits of resource conservation in project areas. People's participation is must for watershed management works, because if people are convinced with your idea, with your works, then you will get more success. The lack of development in major and minor irrigation projects after 1980 has given impetus to water harvesting. Then there is areas and districts of different states under Shivalik in India. In Himachal Pradesh, 20% area is under Shivalik. In Jammu Kashmir, 17%. In Punjab, it is 11%. In Haryana, 4%. Uttarakhand, 14%. And Chandigarh, it is 100% is Shivalik area. So, because water harvesting or water resource development is the main component in watershed management, and people also, the residents also consider that this should be there. Water should development should be there, and water harvesting should be there, so that they may get the water for the crops. So we will be discussing more about water harvesting. Water harvesting, what is that? It's just a collection of water, run from runoff, steam flow, or and that can be used for irrigation, domestic use, groundwater recharge, etc. And the system should be highly location specific. Next. Water harvesting systems. These are the various systems of water harvesting. Firstly, in situ rainwater harvesting means wherever water is falling, there should be water should be conserved at that place. Then water harvesting ponds. Ponds are there in the various different villages, and they are being desilted, and their life is being increased. And then steam flow harvesting. There are small nala streams and torrents, and water can be harvested through those streams. Through by construction of check dams, earthfill dams, or big dams. Then subsurface water harvesting. In some regions, particularly in hilly area, hilly tract, or in Shivalik region also, actually there is a impermeable layer after 2 meter depth, or say 3 meter depth. So water flows there at the top. There is debris or some sand is there. Then after 2 meter, there is a impermeable layer, clay layer is there. So water flows between that layer. That water can also be harvested. That is known as subsurface water harvesting. There are different techniques for that. Then next is the rooftop water harvesting. And government is also giving more emphasis on this aspect also. Rooftop water harvesting done for surface water storage as well for groundwater recharge. Then usefulness of water harvesting Shivalik region. They are effective in prevention of soil erosion to store surplus rainwater from the catchment area to be used later for irrigation after the withdrawal of monsoon, rehabilitation of the catchment, then recharging groundwater and providing electricity. Design parameters. What are the design parameters for efficient water harvesting? They are engineering survey is done, then preliminary investigation, engineering survey at site, then sedimentation, areas and land use survey, soil characteristics, and geology. Under engineering survey, we go for L section, cross section of the area, then sediment yield. Sediment yield is also estimated. Because when you are going to construct any earthfill dam or big dam, so you should know the sediment yield. If sediment yield is more, your life of the structure will be less. Or you have to go for intensive catchment treatment. And details of catchment and command area. Catchment area is there, then we should know what is the water yield from the catchment and what is the command area where you are going to give the water. Then type of soil and the soil depth, seepage, type of structure, and depth of foundation. So that will depend upon the type of soil strata. Then hydrological design. Hydrological design covers the runoff volume from catchment, peak rate of runoff, and the design frequency. What design frequency you are taking, 25 years or 50 years? Because for bigger dams, we go for 100 years or more frequency also. Some of you might be knowing that what is the rainfall in 25 years, expected rainfall in 25 years or expected rainfall in 50 years, like that. The 25 years frequency, then 50 years frequency. Then hydraulic design, storage capacity and storage dimension of the structure. Height of dam, depth of pond, and spillway dimensions. Then structural design, estimation of dimension of the structure, selection of material for construction, and the factor of safety. Other points which are to be considered are social factors. This is also important. Local scale and site, and social acceptability of the project, people's participation. People are interested or not for your project, whether they like that site or not. Whether that site will be beneficial for them or not, that also we have to consider. Then command area, at least they should get 2-3 irrigation, supplementary irrigation. Then benefit cost ratio, that should not be lost. Project should not be lost, but there should be some benefit from the project. Tangible benefit and intangible benefit. Tangible benefit means direct benefit, and intangible means the benefit coming from indirect things. If you want to ask something, you may ask in between also. And then design of dam, cost of storage to be minimum. Then there should be depth capacity curve. What is the capacity at different depths? Then depth versus submergence area. What is the submergence area at different depths? And then area capacity. What is the capacity at different area? Different submergence area. The how much to store, contour survey are carried out for capacity at the site, and then height is decided as per design capacity or as per site. Then critical parameters, runoff volume, or water LD required to be stored in the water harvesting structure. This is the one of the critical parameter, runoff volume. Second critical parameter is peak rate of discharge or peak rate of runoff. What is peak rate of runoff from the area, from the catchment, so that you can design the spillway or outlet according to peak rate of runoff, because spillway is very important for a design, for a dam. Then sediment yield. What sediment yield you are getting from catchment? You have to design the dam according to sediment yield also. If sediment you are getting more sediment yield, so then you have to go for intensive catchment treatment, or you have to leave that site. This is a simple formula which is generally used, and there are similar other formula, but this is not very simple. Of course, some this runoff coefficient and I needs several judgments. And then for a dam, this is when height is h. This is the different parameters, top width, then side slope, storage, then core wall and key trench is also constructed. Then we have to make a contour map of the pond or dam. Then this is a storage capacity curve, depth versus storage capacity. At what will be the storage capacity at different depths? Now I will go with the case studies. Our research center was established in the year 1956, and after that a lot of research work were carried out in the area, and this the first experiment was on runoff and sediment yield from a micro catchment at research farm. Actually, there was a 21.32 hectare watershed, and a lot of sediment was coming out of that area. So the slope was 36%, soil is sandy loam, land use is protected. After in 1956 onward, it was protected area. Before that, it was not protected. And so sediment load was very high, 150 tons per hectare or more. And after protection and after intervention, means introduction of various soil and water conservation measures, means soil and water conservation means contour trenches, construction of contour trenches, construction of brushwood check dams, and dry stone check dams, and efforts works. The runoff and sediment yield reduced in the area. You can see it went up to, the sediment reduced up to 1 ton per hectare per year in the year 1982-85 block. And after that, it again increased. Because after that, land use or the vegetation changed. Some trees died, and new vegetation like lantana and some other bushes came in the area, which increased the runoff and silt load also. The Sukumaji Dam. Actually, Sukumaji Dam was constructed in the year, four dams were constructed in the area, in the year 75 to 85. So, actually, what happened in the 65 in the year 70s or 75, lot of sediment was coming in the Sukna Lake. Then Chandigarh administration contacted our organization regarding this problem, and then this was the one of the point from where maximum sediment was coming to the Sukna Lake. Then the Sukumaji Dam came into existence. This is a long story, but we cannot tell at this time. This catchment area is 9.2 hectare, capacity is 5.6 hectometer, and the command area is 20 hectare. Wheat yield has increased 4 times, and the water applied on charge basis, by the charges were fixed by the village society, and people's participation was the key factor. These are one of the dam of Sukumaji. Then you can see the water coming from the dam through gravity system, and this is the one of the alpha valve fixed over the riser, and the water is, the maize is also being irrigated. Although maize is produced in the season, in the kharif season when there is monsoon, but sometimes there is long dry spells, so sometimes water is needed. So one life saving irrigation was given to the maize, and so you can see the crop of maize is very good. See, this is the catchment of main dam at Sukumajri before inception of the project. See, in the say in the 1975-76. Then after that, when interventions were done, soil and water conservation measures were carried out. Some soil conservation measures were done in the area, and afforestation were done. You can see the project, the scene after 8-10 years. The lower one, you can see the what is the catchment, the good catchment, good vegetation in the catchment. The unique features of Sukumajri. What are the unique features? They are people themselves are protecting the hills. That is social fencing. Then greenery has returned to the barren and denuded hills that you have seen. Then 3 to 4 times the increase in food and fodder production. Safety against drought. There is no drought in the area, and people are getting supplementary irrigation. And soil erosion has considerably reduced. Groundwater augmentation, groundwater was also increased in the area. Multiple use of water, because water was being not only for irrigation purpose, but for other purposes also, like fisheries. And the big boost to dairy sector. People increased their milching animals. And there a strong link has been established between conservation and production. Conservation of this environment and the production of the crop. Then what is the lesson? People's participation must be ensured if the natural resource management project is to succeed. Then people's participation is difficult to achieve unless they are convinced that they can divert direct and visible benefits from the project. If they are not getting any benefit from the project, they will not take any interest, and they will not participate in your work. The need and the problem of the people must be identified. Unless a project is admitting their needs, solving their problems, and mitigating their hardship, the same may not succeed. Actually, what happens when we go for selection of any WhatsApp project? We carry out various meetings with the villagers. We ask their problems, and after subsequent meetings, we come to know about their problems, and we go to solve their problems to quite a good extent. The constitution of village society must be prerequisite for taking such projects. Village society means when society there, they will take care of the irrigation system, the dam, and water distribution system also. Once the benefits from project start accruing, the people are willing to take up the responsibility of protecting the forest and manage the water distribution system or the dam in the area. Then second is Bunga Dam. Catchment area 155 hectare, capacity 59.6, and command area 69 hectare. 69 area is being irrigated from that. And again, here also you get about more than 4.5 times increase in the yield of wheat because they got water. And Hill Resource Management Society is effective since 1984-85. That is very important. The view of Bunga Dam. The Rail Mara project, this is in Punjab near Ropar. Catchment area 59 hectare, capacity 13.7 hectare. Command area 25 hectare. Crop yield and fodder production increased significantly in the area, and the command area development by farmers themselves. Command area development, they level their fields and they so that water efficiency increased in the area. But in rail mara project, what happened is because of lot of vegetation in the catchment, water yield reduced drastically. and some and sediment also increased, but increased in the area. So, and moreover, after 95, there was low rainfall in the area. So, with the low rainfall and low runoff, the dam could not be filled up completely after 95. Then harvested in rainwater behind earth fill dam. This is VGT filter, under Donex above the submergence area. The VGT filter means if water is passed through this filter, the VGT filter, soil sediment will be stopped behind this, sediment will be arrested, only clean water will go to the dam. So you will get less sediment yield in the dam. The view of desilted pond of Mandala. This was a village in Solan district. And this dam, the pond was not getting any water for a long time because it was silted with the sediment, and the water intake area was also clogged. So it was rejuvenated, and desiltation was done, and now you can see water in the area, and people are using their land with the help of gravity system and lift irrigation system. The multipurpose check dam at Mandala. Actually, why it is multipurpose? Because it is not only collecting the water, but some water is diverted to the pond also. Because when there is less rainfall, less water was reaching to the pond, so some water was diverted from the check dam also to the pond. There, this catchment of this check dam is 8 hectare. This is subsurface storage tank. There is subsurface water, flow of subsurface water in the area, Shivali region. So if the wall at the hillside is porous, some water comes to the small tank, and that can be collected, and this water can be used for irrigation to the irrigation of this vegetables. Then other watershed is Joranpur watershed. This is also located in Solan district of Himachal. This is micro watershed. You can see the area. Here, the dotted line is the catchment area of the water of the pond. But this pond were not getting sufficient water, and desiltation was also required because sediment was deposited in the pond. Now you can see the catchment area was increased of these ponds, and desiltation was also done. More water is harvested, and the area was being irrigated from this pond. This is the diversion channel. Otherwise, water was going outside the area. With the help of diversion channel, more water was coming to the pond. Problems are identified during kharif season: excessive runoff during monsoon season, and soil loss due to water induced erosion, the flooding of lower fields, the removal of nutrients from top productive layer, then lower yields due to water logging. During rabi season, poor germination of rabi crops, the complete failure of crop during 2 out of 5 years, the low productivity in the range of 3 to 5 quintal per hectare. Renovation of pond for rainwater harvesting. The pond was renovated. You can see the renovation of pond by desilting. Year of desilting 2001. Storage capacity increased from 1 to 2.4 hectometer. And the earlier it was 0.7 and 1.7 hectometer respectively. The effect of polythene lining was done actually in the pond number 2. The lot of seepage was there. So after the poly lining, the water loss have drastically reduced. You can see the polythene lining for seepage control. Newly excavated pond has very high seepage rate, and 30 cm boulder layer at 125 5 centimeter depth and lower side of embankment. So there were a lot of seepage. So a 300 micron sheet was laid to control the seepage loss. If you lay a sheet of HDP or LDP, you have to give the cushioning effect to the sheet, and after sheet and over the sheet also, at least 1 feet, 1 foot depth of soil should be there. Because what happens sometimes, kettles may also go in the pond and they may puncture the sheet. If sheet is, if there is soil over the sheet, the chances of puncture will be less. Effect of supplementary irrigation on yield of wheat. Here you can see how the year wise, the in the rain fed and then irrigated area, one irrigation, two irrigation, the yield has increased. In the with rain fed, yield was 9.5 tons per hectare. Sorry, 9.5 quintal per hectare. In with one irrigation, it was 20.72 quintal per hectare, and with two irrigation, it was 36.97 quintal per hectare. Then, water harvesting in different watersheds. What is the catchment area to storage capacity ratio that is shown here for Sukumari Dam 1, Dam 2, Dam 3, and Dam 4? Catchment area is given, then storage capacity is given, then command area is also given. Then you can see the catchment area area per hectare of storage capacity 5.26 in case of first, and it was minimum was 1.49. Catchment area to storage capacity means in the second, third, and fourth, more water was there in the dam. Then Mandhara Pond area is catchment area 4.2 and storage capacity 2.08. Storage 2, then command area is 10 hectare. So we get about 50% water from the catchment. Then Jorarpur, 8.5 is the catchment area, and 3.57 is the ratio for the catchment area to storage capacity. Then Nada 1, Nada 2, Nada 3 also, this is given. For Rail Maja and Bunga, it is given. For Bunga, it is 2.86. Then benefit cost ratio of some water harvesting projects. We are giving benefit cost ratio of each water harvesting structure in the Haryana, Punjab, and Himachal Pradesh. Haryana, it is Sukumari 2.5, Punjab 1.58, Himachal Pradesh 2.38. Then siltation rate after the treatment of the watershed. In the base year, the siltation rate was low. Siltation rate was high. Farm pond choke aging 37 in 1965, and after treatment it is 1 ton per hectare per year, 97% reduction there. And in Sukumaji 1 and Sukumaji 2, it is given 68 to 65% reduction. And Nada 1, 2, 3, it is 32 to 72% reduction. And the Rail Maja is in reduction 91%. And Bunga is 92%. So when some watershed activity is there, watershed management activity is there, so the silted rate is also reduced. Recommendations are, a successful water harvesting technology should have provision of 2 to 3 supplementary irrigation at critical crop growth stages in the entire watershed area. Looking into the Shivali condition, it is possible to develop an appropriate technology if the region receives a rainfall around or above 1000 millimeter annually and is able to produce about 25% runoff, so that on an average 250 millimeter water is harvested. The donor area is also benefited with the harvested rainwater in case of agriculture watershed. People's participation can be more insured. In general, 1 hectare meter water can be harvested from a catchment around 3 hectare in Shivali region, depending upon the catchment characteristics, because soil is generally sandy loam. And catchment area treated and social fencing is adopted for sustained water yield with minimum silt. The earthen dams are constructed with proper technology. Proper technology should be adopted, and the watershed management approach is in participatory mode. Then torrent training work was also done in the area. There are torrents also in the watersheds, so they were also treated. See, here you can see the spur, spur in a torrent, in a stream. Spur is there. So spurs are generally three types. Generally, we use attacking type spurs. Attacking type spurs means they are deflected. They are at some angle to downstream side. Then again, mechanical spurs. So actually, they should be have proper contact in the side. Anchoring should be there in the sides in the stream bank, so that water may not go. Between the structure and from between between the structure and the stream bank. The again sacrum munja is planted in deposition. You can see the foundation is also there. Some spur is there in foundation also, and sacrum munja with the vegetative measure is also there. This is a combination of both measures for the in the spur. For vegetative treatment in the torrent stream bank in the interspace, ipomia is used. This ipomia, then bamboo, and then nada, munj, these are used in the area. And this can be used in other areas also. I think some plants may be used in other areas also. Other area means other than Shivalik area. Then the latest was the Kajana watershed. This is the water flow in the area, but whatever being wasted in the area, one small pool was there. A pool means a small channel was there, and a lot of water were being lost from that channel. So we went for underground pipeline system. Underground pipeline system was laid in the area, and the water conveyance efficiency was increased. In the initial stage, we go for entry point activities, repair and renovation of Dharmasala in Naladagro. Because when you are going to for participatory mode, then you have to give some benefit to the villagers. They should be convinced that we have come in the in their villages or in the watershed for their benefit. The construction of boundary around primary school in the Togda, the renovation of panchayat ghars in Janoli and Kajana. These are the villages in the watershed, and repair of water storage tank to collect surface water and recycle it for supplementary irrigation. Capacity building is also an important component. Some 60 farmers were trained in soil and water conservation. They were taken to Dehradun also, and 3-day training program were organized from 12 May 2009 to 14 May 2009, and later on also. Then watershed works. Lot of silt was coming in the area, in the Kajana. Then 9 gabion structures in the series have been constructed to stabilize the gully head in the village generally. Gabion structures are nothing but they are crate-wise structures. Stones or boulders are kept in the crate wire in a rectangular fashion. Then a masonry check dam to harvest the rainwater and stabilize gully and protect the adjoining field in Kajana. A masonry check dam was also constructed. And the repair of water storage tank in to store water from subsurface in village Dhatogar to check wastage of subsurface water, harvested rainwater. Actually, there was a subsurface rainwater pipe also which was being collected in a tank. But tank was leaking, so that tank was repaired, and after that, that water was being used for irrigation purpose. Then improving water management. See, you can see the water was flowing in the first picture, first at top, water flowing the open channel. Then the underground pipeline system was laid, and the you can see the one box is there. Box with this box we can see whether some clogging or we can clean the area, clean the pipe. This is between joints of pipe. You can put a you can make a box also, and you can see the diameter pipe. This is the 10 inch diameter pipe which was laid in the area. Then this is water distribution system. You see where the three children are staying. Water was flowing like this earlier, but lot of water was being wasted. Then the underground pipeline system was laid in the area, alfalfa wall was given at the risers, and the entire area is being irrigated with the help of underground pipeline now. And water is not being wasted, and more area has come under irrigation. Under supplementary irrigation. We carry out hydrological study also because our organization is a research organization. Silt observation posts are constructed for measuring runoff and sediment yield. You can see here the broadcast weir is there, and hydrological chart, where hydrological charts are put on the machine. That room is there, and you can see during the 2009, 2010, 2011, you can see the runoff and soil loss has reduced drastically in the area because some interventions were carried out in the area, catchment area, and so the runoff and soil loss reduced in the area. You can see the land usage. In WhatsApp 1, the area is 22 hectare, WhatsApp 2, 5.62, WhatsApp 3, 11 hectare, WhatsApp 4, 481 hectare. So these were the WhatsApp, and you can see the land use also, agriculture 30%, forest 70%, then agriculture 100%, agriculture 80%, forest 20%, then complete WhatsApp. Complete WhatsApp was also gauged at the end. In the one of the lower picture, you can see a lot of sediment is coming in the beginning here. In the first year, 2009. After that, gabion structure was constructed in that nala. So then after that, no bed load came in the SOP.
Yes, albums are mistakes.
Of albums.
Then this is self-help group called like livelihood security. In the watershed management projects, we have to give benefit to the farmers in different ways. Self-help, the ladies are being trained in the stitching and toy making also, and then there was a right distribution function also for them. Impacts. The common watershed guidelines proved effective in organizing local community and involving them in managing natural resources on watershed basis. The implementation of watershed development plan led to reduced runoff and soil loss. Then saved water during conveyance, diversified cropping pattern, then successful demonstration of crop production technique like integrated nutrient management, organic farming, and crop diversification led to large scale adoption. Actually, mainly I am showing the engineering part. There are actually in watershed management we go for different parts like agronomical parts, then soil condition, the soil science part also. Then horticulture also, forestry also, aspects also. So different. We work in different aspects. Landless and women are empowered through enhancing livelihood security. Some social scientists are working for that. Then in some areas, jute geotextile net was used in the areas where there were landslide to control the landslide. There actually no other measure are successful in such areas. So we go for jute geotextile. Actually, jute geotextile, this is available in different density. This is net. The holes in the net are in the 1 inch by 1 inch or 2 inch by 2 inch like that. And they are having different density, 500, 600, 700 like that. Gram, according to weight, the density is decided. So this is laid in the sloping area where there is mass erosion. Then with the help of PECs, this is PECs are laid in the area, in the PECs are driven in the over the net so that it is fixed in the area. And then you can plant some vegetation and sow some seeds. After 2-3 years, what will happen? This jute, your textile will degrade, and it will become too. The organic matter will be developed in the area, and vegetation will come up. I can show you one side. Where this is the upper side is the area where there was mass erosion, landslide were there, and then we went for laying the jute geotextile in the area. You can see the laying of jute geotextile. Then first year of laying jute, you can see the grasses have come up, and after 2 years. This is the portion. The last slide shows what is the vegetation in the area. So vegetation come up. Now you cannot identify whether this area was earlier as mass origin area or not. Sometimes we go for construction of pond also, and when we go for construction of pond or we distill the pond, in the beginning lot of seepage is there. So we have to go either for some polythene lining or permanent lining. Here permanent lining has been done with the help of cement concrete, and some RCC work put in the RCC work was done in the bottom because this is a totally sandy area. Then intake inlet is there and outlet there. Many times you see in the ponds, ponds are there. But there is no inlet or no outlet. Inlet should also be there. Actually, what is happening from old age, ponds are there in the villages, in the most of villages. But due to encroachment in the catchment, less water is reaching to the less water is coming to the pond. So this catchment area is to be cleared for coming for water, and so that sufficient water comes to the pond. And when pond is filled up with the water, and that should go safely from the outlet. This is augmenting of drinking water resources. This was our project where we evaluated the soil and the water conservation measures. In the catchment area, some contour trenches were constructed, and in the streams, some gabion structures and brush root check dams were constructed. And after a few years, the bowdies or the subsurface water sources which were dry, the water was stored, water came in the those structures because of recharging of groundwater. Actually, what happens when we go for intensive catchment treatment, water goes to the goes in the soil and comes through subsurface, comes in the subsurface form. So you can see the bowdy is full of water, and when earlier people were going lot of distance for taking water, they can get the water at their village. With the help of soil conservation measures, there was improvement in base flow also. In the watershed area, earlier there was no base flow in the area in the watershed. So you can see number of perennial estuarines, number pre-project stage 27 and after project 39. In 39 projects there were perennity, means water was coming throughout the year. The length of base flow in torrents in kilometer 58 up to 58 kilometer, and in some after project in 198 kilometer. Then duration of base flow in months 0 to 3, then 4 to 6, 7 to 9, and 10 to 12 it is given. The pre-project it was 9 in some of the project, and after that it came to 28 for the entire year, means the perennial flow. Then discharge of base flow, and discharge is also there, poor, moderate, high, and very high. You can see after project it is 0 and then 17, then 15 and 7, like that. This is in Q6. So So with the help of soil and water conservation structure measures, groundwater is the groundwater recharged, and you can get more subsurface flow, and perennity is and you can get the perennial water from the rivers and streams. So this is all about my presentation. Now I will I have kept some time for discussion also.